have around more than 3 to 3.5 years experience in teaching. Still now I have trained more than 1,500 to 1,600 students, both direct sessions and all over corporate levels I have taken over here. So this is the first time I'm taking it for Wipro. So this is a short intro about myself over there. So I think everyone can view my screen also. Today I'm gonna just give a small brush up which has been happened before. So I'll just take module 1 and module 2 once again to you guys. Okay. My name is Murali. My name is Murali Shalini. Okay, yeah. So, can we start the show? I think we are at the time. So, I'll just start the basics. Okay. So, I'll just give a small recap as what are the things I was there. Don't think bored over there. Okay, just be with me for some time because all the things which you have heard, I'm gonna tell you. Okay, just don't be bored over there. Okay, I'll just give a small brush up and then we'll go with the proper level. So, first, I'll start with how a Java program works over there. I'll just show you some. A little bit screens over there because I start first I want to make your foundation level a little bit in a good shape over there, because once you know that concept, going with further is easier for you. Okay, so mostly I'm gonna talk to you about, not mostly about syntax alone, mainly I'm gonna talk to you about at the back end level how the memory allocations are going to happen over there, because if you know that concept, understanding any language is easier. Okay, syntax is what gonna change for every language, but 75% every programming backend work remains same over there. So I'm going to teach you about that concept. Once you learn this Java, learning the Java, Ruby or any language should be easier for you. That's the concept I'm going to take you, and then that's the way I'm going to teach you also. Okay, the beginning stage I might be going a little slow, like that you might feel. If you're getting bored or something, please give me the information so we can start over there. Okay, yeah. Okay guys. So now I'll just go for the might be everyone might be installed your Eclipse and that tool, but even though actually I'll be just sharing you some screens over there. So how my entire documents I have prepared over there, I'll just tell you over there. Okay, before starting, so you might be having a good understanding that actually how my classes will go. So most of the classes which I'm going to take over there, everything is documented. And then if I'm going to explain you about any software or something, any download part or installation part, okay, everything will be with screenshots over there. So because most of my students over there, when they come to the installation part, they might be missing out something. So they might be in trouble. So to make sure that not to happen, I'll make sure that actually every installation part will be with screenshots, and then a written document will be there. So this is for Java installation. Okay, the same thing if you are going for the Eclipse level download, and then how to write a program over there. For that also, I have given you with screenshots and the document over there. I'm just running it faster over there. So anyway, I'll be sharing this document to you guys. Okay, and then I'll be just going through this also. Okay, so this is how my documents I'll be sharing to you guys. Okay, everything will be with a clear document will be there. So first I'll start how a normal program executes and then how a Java program executes over there. Okay. So first, if you see over there how a normal program executes, means I'll just open a file. So from my side, actually whatever the programs we are writing, okay, those things are called as statements. Okay, any program which we write, okay, so in Java system.out.println, okay, that's a statement over there. Okay, every information is called as a statement over there. Okay, the program which is written by a human being is called as a high level language. Okay, those statements cannot be directly understandable by our system, so we need a translator to make sure that machine can understand it. Machine can understand only one information, that is a machine language, which is zeros and ones. Based on that only it will act accordingly what we need to do. So the translator is of two types, one is compiler and then interpreter. Both the compiler and interpreter will help you to translate, that's what it's going to do. But the small difference between the compiler and interpreter is what means totally 1,000 lines of program is there under my file, means totally all the 1,000 lines will be compiled, then only it will be pushed to the CPU. Interpreter level, every line by line it will compile and then okay, that means it will convert into machine level language, then it will push to CPU for execution. Compiler 1,000 lines are totally converted, then only execution starts. Interpreter level, line by line the conversion happens and then only my execution starts over there. That's what is going to happen here. Okay, so a simple, okay, you guys might have been learned in your school days or something. Okay, the same thing is what I'm just recap, doing a recap to you guys to make it understand. Okay, so before the programs came all are of compiler type or might be interpreter type alone, but nowadays actually what everything is combination of a compiler and interpreter. The same thing, Java is a combination of the compiler and plus interpreter. What is the problem if you go with interpreter level or if you go with the compiler level means? Okay, so compiler level, if you go over there, the initial startup time will be little bit less for you to start the program, because 1,000 or 2,000 lines of code is there in your file, means entirely it has to compile and check whether any syntax error is present or not. Okay, that's what it's going to do. Okay, and finally it starts to execute the program. But once it starts to execute the program, syntax level errors it will not throw, because already it has been checked over there and then only we are going to start it. Interpreter level, if you go line by line, it's going to convert you and then execution is going to happen. In case in my 750th line, if I'm going to find any syntax error, it stops over there and then once again I need to clear the error, once again I need to start. The initial startup time might be faster, but any errors comes over there, it will be a problem in the interpreter level. That's the difference between the compiler and interpreter level. So in order to handle that one, Java works with both compiler and then interpreter level for us. That's what. So what this compiler and then this interpreter, how is going to work, we'll see. So first, okay, my programs will be written in a file. Okay, any program or any information that you write, you have to save it with an extension over there. If it's a notepad, .txt. If it's actually a Excel file, .xls, .xlsx, wordpad, .word. Okay, same like the Java, it has .java. Okay, so but once you have compiled, then there is a question from Ranjanesh. But once you have compiled, then at runtime is Java still interrupted, interpreted? Yes, correct. Okay, what the compiler will do means, okay, it's going to find me any syntactical error is present or not. That's what it's going to do. Interpreter level will take the usage of the execution part. Step line by line execution starts. Okay, based on that only memory allocations will be happen for us. That's the only good. Okay, am I clear, Ranjanish? This was your question, no? Yeah. Okay. So now I'll come back. Okay. So any program that will be saved in a dot extension file in Java, it is dot Java. Okay. So my Java first, my files will be given to a compiler. Okay, so what the compiler will do means, okay, it will convert that file to a dot class file. Okay, it's going to convert to a bytecode over there. That's what it's going to do. Okay, it's also going to convert to a different, that is actually what, a machine level language, zeros and ones only, but in a different format over there. Okay, dot Java file is my statements file that is being converted to a dot class file. Okay, with help of a Java compiler. Then after that, that file will be given to the JVM. So what is this JVM means? Java Virtual Machine. So this dot class file is an interesting information over there in Java. What is the thing means? Actually, this class file can be read only by a person called JVM. Okay, apart from JVM, no one can read it. And then also it's secured over there. They are making it a little bit secure level also. Okay, why? How they this part came over here is, okay, right now if you see, okay, right now we are doing it over there. Okay, for example, Wipro is a company, okay, it's a service based company or a product based company over there, okay, which you're going to write some programs, developing a program application, okay, and then you want to show that information to the application customer. That application to the customer means, okay, what you will be doing means you will be sending the class files as a zip and then you will be sending to them for execution. Okay, just think over, okay, don't think in a very broad level, okay, just make sure to understand the concept, that's what I'm doing, okay. So you will be sending only the class file, you will not be sending the Java file. What is the advantage of this one means your logic and then the entire code is safe, that is no one can read this information, okay. So the class file can be read only by the JVM, apart from that no one can open and then can understand the logic here, okay. So the class file is needed for the execution level for us, okay. This class file will be given to the JVM for execution and then your application runs. That's what is going to happen. So your code is secured over here. So then that bytecode, okay, the class file is given to JVM. What it will do means now only the interpreter will take that, okay. So it convert that bytecode into a machine level language, okay, an understandable bytecode, and again it's zeros and ones, okay, that will be given to the CPU for execution. Now the execution will start over with what interpret level line by line execution will happen. Here execution time any errors comes over there, that will be taken part. Okay. Java compiler totally what entire statements will be compiled and then after that will be given to the CPU for execution. That's what is going to do. Clear? Is this concept clear over there? Okay. Just a small recap. A Java file, dot Java file where the statements will be written, it will be compiled over there, that compiler creates me a dot class file, then that class file is given to a JVM, then the JVM again do an interpret level execution, converts an another level of bytecode, then finally given to the CPU for execution. That's it. So, yes, so if everyone, if it's clear over there, just reply. In case if you have any doubts or something, please reply me. Okay. So I'll just explain you one more time also. Okay. You can ask me a number of times. I'm ready to explain for 10 times. But make sure you understand the concept. Okay. So now we'll see a little bit. Okay. JVM is needed for Java to run the class file. Okay. JVM is needed for Java to run the class file over there. Because I told that class file can be understandable only by the JVM. Okay. So we need JVM to run the Java, correct, okay. To install the JVM we need JRE. What is this JRE? This Java runtime environment. What is this Java runtime environment means? Okay, any program, okay, or any information that you want to run, there should be a runtime environment. That is actually what it needs to run its program at the back end over there. So there is an environment needed for it, okay, that is called as Java runtime environment. Okay, so there only your Java programs will execute it. So if you install actually what Ruby, for that an environment is needed to run their code over there. That is what, okay, a runtime environment actually what is back end, their codes are going to be run. That's it. That is runtime environment over here. Okay, JRE is called as Java runtime environment. JVM is called as Java virtual machine. We also need JDK. What is this JDK means? Is the Java development kit, which is an entire set, okay, which will consist of the Java compiler, JVM plus JRE, okay, everything will be there in a single package over there. That is the JDK, the entire kit over here. So if you install JDK, automatically you will be getting the JRE plus JVM plus compiler. If you install JRE only, you will be getting the JRE. So usually we install the entire kit over there, because we need actually what, when you come to the Selenium part over there, we need the JDK to run some informations over there. That's the thing. Okay. So interpreter, I told you over there, compiler, all the same informations I'm just explaining over here. Shalini, still my voice is it breaking? Is my voice is clear or still is breaking? Now it's fine. Can I continue the session? Okay. So any doubts as of now, as what I have thought, you can just give me a little bit comments to me, whether I'm slow or whether I'm fast or I'm going in a proper phase to make you understand. If there are any problem is there with my session, you can just tell me over there so I can make it according to you. Because I'm going with this session over there because I might be feeling whether I'm going in a proper phase, so you can just give me whether if I'm going properly or not. Okay, yeah, sure. So I'll just go with the same speed. So if anything is there, you just please let me know over there. Okay, so I'll just tell you over there actually a little bit about the installation part over there. Okay, I'll just go a quick overthrough. Okay, so the same thing what I'm going to explain you, that is also present over there in this document over there. Okay, so first I want to install my Java JDK. Okay, how to install that Java, the JDK over there means. Okay, so first I need to know whether in my system do I have the JDK in my system over there. JDK comes in Eclipse. Okay, so it's not JDK. What is the question over here means actually, what does JDK comes in Eclipse? Okay, Eclipse is what means, it's a supportive tool for writing the program. Okay, so Java is what means actually, what in your system you are going to install Java, so the Java level execution will happen. So for example, sometimes actually what when you are trying to install some download and then install some software and then trying to run, that time it will be asking you can install actually what Java or can install some Adobe or something like that. Okay, what is the thing means actually, what there are supportive tools to run for that actually, what there is some programs that need to be run at the back end. Okay, so Java is like that. Okay, Eclipse is what means, it's like a notepad. Okay, instead of writing your programs in a notepad, okay, we have Eclipse, NetBeans, like those tools over there which support for me to write the programs over there. What that will do means actually, what it will help me to write the programs in an easier way. Okay, already some inbuilt informations have been done, makes my life easier to write the program in a faster way. There are some shortcuts. For example, I want to type system.out.println and then I want to print it. In the notepad, I need to type system.out.println. Same thing in Eclipse. Just if I give SYSO, then if I press control space, there is a shortcut, control space if I press, I will be getting system.out.println. What will happen? That gives me, and then I can just do it. So makes my typing the program in a faster way. That's what Eclipse will do. It's just as simpler as like a notepad. That's it. Okay, JDK is what means, is the entire kit which helps me to run the Java programs at the back end. That's what it's going to do. I'm good with the explanation, Ramesh. That's what your question, I think so. Yeah. Okay. So now, I'll just tell you over there, how do I know that actually what I have my Eclipse in my system or not. So I'm gonna press Windows R button. Okay, that opens me this run. Okay, so the shortcut is Windows R. Now I'll type CMD, then click on OK. I'll be getting my command prompt. So to confirm actually what Java is present over there, I can type Java space hyphen version. That will give me the version of my Java over there, 1.8. Okay, so in case if it's giving you actually Java is not a recognized command or something like that, I need to install Java. To install Java over there, okay, I can directly go with the JDK download itself, because I told you JDK will be the full set which installs me Java compiler JVM plus JRE. Okay, so I'll just go to my Google Chrome, then I'm gonna give you JDK download. Okay, I'm gonna Google for JDK download. Okay, you can choose whether it's in Windows 7 or something whichever you want. So I went over here. So here I'll just take over there the latest version, Java AC development kit downloads over there. I can just go over here. I can go to the first one also. Okay, it directly goes to the environment. Okay, so this also will come over here. See, downloads, it comes over here. Otherwise actually, if I go to the first URL, okay, I'll be coming over here. Here I need to set Java, okay, JDK. Okay, I need to click on this one. So now Java EC development kit 8U. So here I need to click over there. Okay, there are two things over there, 8U, 8U92. Those are different versions. So I'll just go with 8U91. Accept license agreement over there. Once you click on it, here there are two things, Windows X 86 and then 64. 86 is what means actually what? You are saying 32-bit version, 64 is actually what? Your 64-bit version. How you can confirm your system level version means just go here, go to my computer, right click, go to your properties, then you can see here 64-bit machine. Okay, this will show that actually what is your 64-bit machine. So in case if it's a 32-bit machine, you will be directly getting only this small window alone. That means yours is a 32-bit machine over here. That's the thing. Okay, so now mine is 64-bit machine. I'm going to click on this one. Once I click on it, I'll be getting a RAR file. Okay, sorry, I will be getting a .exe file. Just double click on the .exe file and click on next, 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 and then your JDK will be installed. Okay, nothing is there. Next, 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 JDK will be installed. So that's what I explained to you here. See, click on this one, click on this information, click on next, 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 your JDK is being installed. So now if I come over to my program files, okay, go to the C drive, okay, all your programs always, okay, any installation you do, okay, by default it will be installed over there in your program files folder, okay. So I'll just go over here, you can see a folder name called Java, okay. So if it's a 64-bit machine, I'll be getting both program files x86, this for 32, this for 64. I have selected 64, so that's why my information comes over here. So I'll go to the Java folder, then you can see JDK and then JRE, two folders. If I install only JRE, I'll be getting only this folder. If I install JDK, I'll be getting these two folders coming over here. That's what. Okay, so now I have installed the JRE and JDK. Now I need to set the path. I told you that actually what I need to set the runtime environment. Okay, so the runtime environment is what I'm going to do. So you go to the JDK folder, go to the bin folder, then copy the path of it. Then come to the Windows over here, then right click on computer, go to properties, then click on advanced system settings, advanced tab, environment variables, then come to the system variables, go for path. Okay, then right click, sorry, click on edit. Okay, then you will be getting this variable values over here. Okay, so see, for each and any programs when you install it over there, automatically when I want to install Skype, automatically this path is set over there. Okay, any files when I'm going to do it, okay, the path is needed because there only the environment will be running over there. So now I need to give one semicolon, then I need to paste it over here, then give a semicolon and click on OK. I have already given my information, so I'm just not giving over there. So you have to paste it, click on OK, and then after that click on again OK over there. So your JDK path is set right now. Okay, so now you come to your command prompt, then if you type Java space hyphen version, okay, when you press the top arrow, automatically the previous command which I typed over it will come, then when you type it, your version will come as of now. So now you are set with the Java installation and the JDK installation. That's it. Okay, the same thing is what I have given over here. Okay, no need to worry if I'm going these things a little bit fast because I already have the document. So everything I mentioned, giving a semicolon, all information have been given. No need to worry. So the Java version, everything has been done. Okay, so now Java and JDK is done. Now I'll go to the Eclipse. So what are the Eclipse? I told you it's a supportive tool for me to install it. Okay, how to install the Eclipse? Okay, you can write your programs in actually what, Notepad, otherwise Notepad++, and then Sublime, like a lot of tools, but Eclipse is the best tool which supports for your Java. Okay, there are some other tools, NetBeans, like that also, but Eclipse is a famous tool over here. How to install the Eclipse over there means, so I'll just go over here. Once again, I'm going to Google. Okay, Eclipse download over there. Okay, so Eclipse download. Okay, for Windows 7 or whatever I want over there, I can give. Otherwise, I'll just give Eclipse download. I'll click on this one. Just a second, it's loading. Okay. Okay, I'll be getting this section. Here you have to select, right now the latest version is Eclipse Mars. Okay, so you have to select Windows or Linux or what. So minus Windows over there, I'll select Windows. Then here Eclipse IDE for Java W developers. Okay, there are a lot of types of different of versions will be there. In that, Java W developers is what I want. Okay, so here I need to click whether it's 32-bit or 64-bit. Minus is 64-bit, so I'll click on this one. Then you will be getting an option for downloads. Okay, see, you will be getting here download. Click on this download .rar. A zip file will be downloaded for you. Okay, it will be like this. So I already downloaded. There will be a rar file which I will be getting it like this. Okay, when I extract, right click, extract the file, you'll be getting a folder called here Eclipse. Okay, for Eclipse there is no installation, directly download and use the file. Okay, then after that you will be getting any application over here like this. Just click on this Eclipse. Okay, so now I got my Eclipse over here. So usually it will be pointing to C drive. Okay, I don't want to save my files over there in my C drive or something. Okay, I want to do it in a, save it in a different location. I click on browse. Okay, usually don't try to save it in C drive because anything happens over there, they format the C drive. So better to save it in a different location. Okay, then I'll go to my D drive over there. So right now I'll select the D drive. Then I will be creating a folder. Okay, I'll just create in the D drive. I need to create a folder or some other I want. I want to create a new D drive itself. Make new folder, I'm clicking. Learn Eclipse. I just gain. Then I'll click on OK. Now if you see the D drive, Learn Eclipse will come. So here if you see this drop down will give you the information as which path you have to go. Okay, so minus right now I want to go to the my information, sorry, I just browse one more time the D drive. Learn Eclipse is what mine. I click on OK and then make sure you don't want to click on this one, because actually what if you not click, then each and every time it will ask you. So in case always you want to work with the same folder location, you can just go with like this, then click on OK. So I am using the older version which is Eclipse. You will be having Mars over there. Okay, just the UI changes will be happened over there. That's the only thing. So now if I come over there to my section, okay, so what are the folder I have created over there means actually what it has been created over there, Learn Eclipse. I'll just double click it. So can you see these two files, a temporary files will be created. Okay, so here is the place actually what I'm going to create my Eclipse environment over there. Okay, the project location, all those things will be loaded here. So for that the supportive files will be here. That's the main thing. Okay, project files, all those things. Okay, so these are not that much needed for us. We'll go over here. So I'll close this welcome screen. What is this welcome screen? Will just give you an overview tutorials like that, how to use Eclipse. That's it. Right now I don't want this, I close it. Okay, so I'll be getting a window like this. Okay, so right now I don't want this outline and then task list. Okay, so markers, I don't want properties, servers, data. Okay, these things will be used by the developers over there. So from my side, when I come to the Selenium, I'll be using very small, some very small windows only. So this is the project explorer window where your project files will be located over there. Okay, so I'll be creating projects, packages, classes like that. Okay, I'll let you know what all those things. So those informations will be written here. This is the place where your programs will be viewed over there. Okay, so your programs will be viewed in this right side place. Okay, now I'm going to create a project. I'll create file, go to new, first go to project. Okay, so directly if I get Java project, I can click on the Java project. Okay, because I'm going to work with the Java project. Okay, there are a lot of projects over there. So right now I'll click on project. That will open me this wizard. So here you can select Java project. Otherwise go to Java folder, go to Java project, click on next. Then I need to select my environment, which is Java SE 1.7 or 1.8, which will be coming. Okay, so your side you're installing new Linux, so you might be getting 1.7 or 1.8 over there. Most probably 1.8, you might be getting it. Select it. Then I'm going to give my project name. So project name, I'll give my first project. I'll just give you. Okay, my first project I'll give you. Then I'll click on finish. Okay, what are the changes I have done is I changed the environment to 1.7. I gave my project name. See the location. It's taking my learn Eclipse, my first project. In case if you uncheck this one, you can also select the location where you want to have it. So in case if I want to create that project in a different location also, it's possible for me to do from here. Okay, I'll go with this one. Click on finish. Then it will be asking you, okay, I'm selecting Java project over there. So if you see over there, at the right side, you can see only Java WE right now. That is J2WE. So I want Java. So when I click on this one, it will create me one more menu over here, this right side. See, I'm going to click on yes. Okay, that gives me Java. Okay, this is the place where I'm going to want. This is my environment for me to work. Okay, this is what I need. So the problems that the keyword gives me, when I'm going to find any errors or something, that will be shown in that this window. Okay, Java docs, actually what if I'm going to install any Java docs to my Eclipse over there, I can see my Java docs over there. Okay, declaration is just simple, a normal information. So I close these things as of now. I don't want to confuse myself as of now. Then task list not needed, outline not needed. Okay, now I created the project over here. So it got me the source folder and then the JRE system library. Shalini, still my voice is not clear. Hey guys, can everyone hear? Shalini, you are facing problems still? Okay, others, everyone can hear me? Okay, so is my voice is clear or you are getting any trouble hearing my voice? Okay, yeah. Okay, sometimes it's breaking. Oh yeah, thank you. Thanks, Sapna. I was facing problem earlier with what after that I used cell phone to connect. Okay, sure. Okay, guys, I'll just show over. So I created my project, everything over here. Okay, so my project is clear. Okay, here if you see, okay, I'm gonna give you some information over here. Okay, so that is to make sure you understand the concept properly. So that's what I'm doing over here. So this is my Eclipse view. So why I'm teaching you this one, okay, this is not that much important over there, but I want you guys to understand, because later part you will be very clear that actually what is the view in the original place and then in the backend place over there. Okay, so this is the original folder location view. I'll tell you what I'm telling, what I'm doing. Original folder view. So what is this original folder view? What is Eclipse view means? Okay, so right now I created a new project, correct? So in my new project right now, what? So this is my project. It has a source folder and then a JRE system library. So what is this JRE system library means? When I open that one, it's going to consist of a lot of jar files. What are these jar files means? Simple. Okay. What is my jar file means? It consists of some packages. Okay. So mainly we have to look on the java.util. That is a package. There will be a number of packages which supports. Okay. The main package is java.util package is what we used to say. So if I open this package, you can see lot of class files over there. What are these class files? I already told you at the beginning. That is your code. Okay, so you will be writing your Java file. That Java file, what will happen? That will be compiled and then it will be creating a class file which can be understandable only by the JVM. Correct? So that is what this type of class files over there. Okay, already codes are written. Okay, if I am going to open some files over here, for example, I'll just click on this base64.class. Okay, it's a Java file. When it's compiled, it becomes a class file. So for my execution, class file is enough for me. Okay, I don't, that is actually, they don't want to share the code to them. Okay, so they don't, they want only the class files I should view. So that's why they give it. If I open this one, this will give me, okay, so base64 class over there. Okay, can you see these are all methods? There are these methods which are all available for me and constants available over there. So like these, they will be giving me information over there, what is present here, what are the classes that we have, and what are the method that we have, what are the variables we have, like those informations will be given over here. So I can access the file, but I cannot open the file. That's the only thing. Okay, that is what they have done over here. All the jar files consist of the internal programs, okay, the class files which will help me to support, because I told you Eclipse is a supportive tool for me. When I'm going to type some information, with shortcuts I can get those information. For all those things, these jar files will help me to get those things. That's what JRE system library is, a collection of the jar files. Jar files is a collection of the packages and classes over there to support my execution. That's it. Okay, so in my, okay, this is my project. Okay, I'm just, this is my project. There is a question. But if I'm not using Eclipse, but Notepad, okay. What is this, Vanjanish? Then how do I get supporting? That's what. So that time what will happen, that entire support is what means actually what you have to type the entire command. System.out.println, class ABC, syntax level, any errors, okay. So compile, when you compile the program, that only you, that time only actually what you can find the errors. But if I use Eclipse, whenever I'm typing the program only, I will be getting my compilation error and all those things. Okay, I'll be showing you what is the advantage of using the Eclipse over there. Okay, Notepad is what means you have to type it properly. When you compile, it will show you in which line the error is. But in Eclipse level, the compilation I can make it easily. Okay, when I'm typing the information only, it will show you the error. Otherwise, when I save the program, it will be showing me the error. That time I can clear the errors on spot. That's the usage of using the Eclipse over there. Okay, guys. So now this is my project. Okay, so I created one project over there. My project name is, okay, so what is the project name? My first project. Okay, so I want to take this name. So shortcut is what? Press F2. Okay, if I press F2, I can copy this one. I got this one. So I just type it over there, my first project. I got it. Okay, so this is what. Then it is having a source folder and then the JRE system library. So I'll have this information. It has a, over here, then it has a JRE system library for me here. It has a JRE system. Okay, this is a source folder. Then this is the JRE system library. JRE system library over there. Okay, so I got this one. This is what present under my Eclipse view. The same thing, I go to the original folder view. So here, that is Learn Eclipse is my place where I created the Eclipse view over there. If I go inside, you can see there is a folder called My First Project has been created. Okay, then if I go over there, I'm having settings, bin, source, class path, project file, like that, lot of things. So this source folder and then bin folder is needed for me. So here, if you see my first project, I have my source folder and then bin folder. Okay, so I'll copy this one. The same thing is going to come. I'll just copy. I'll just say, okay, I have my first project. I have my source folder over here. Then the JRE system library is not there. I'll just go over here. Okay, I got this one. Along with that, I told you that actually there is a another bin folder also. So I'll take that one also. There is another one which is bin folder for me. Okay, I'll just give the same. Okay, I'll just give it a different color. So there is a bin folder for me. This one. So this is what is there. Clear? So other things, actually what we have settings and all those things, that's not needed as of now, because these two are important for me. If I go over, right now this folder is empty, source folder. If I come to the bin folder, the folder is empty. Now what I'm going to do, okay, I'm going to come to my Eclipse. First I'm going to create a package. So how the flow will be, okay, first I create the project, then under the source folder, I need to right click, new package, okay, project, package, then class, okay, I'm going to create a package. Package is what means, actually what is a folder which is going to have some contents of my Java files or the class files over there. That's what it's going to do. I'm creating my package, first package. See, when I'm typing something over here, I'm getting some discouraged package name over there. What is the discouraged package name or something means? That is, usually package starts with the lowercase. Okay, package starts with the lowercase. So I need to always start my package with lowercase. That's a proper name. Okay, it's not mandatory, it's the standard way of giving it. That's it. Then I click on finish. See, I created the package. Okay, now I'll come to this view. So what I did in the source folder, I have created you one package. Okay, I created you one package over here. So what is the package name right now means? First package I created. So I created here. Then after that, next, I'll come to the original folder view. So inside the source folder, if you see, one folder has been created. If I go inside, nothing is present. Same thing if I come to the bin folder, there also, can you see, the first package has been created. So in the source folder and then also in the bin folder, for me, same information. A copy what I'm doing over there in the source folder will be taken over there in the bin folder also. That's what, okay. So I'll copy the same thing. So it's over here. So it's there in the bin folder also. I got this one. Okay, then now I'm going to create a class. Right click on the package, new class. When you click here, you can see some information. Can you see source folder? My first project under source, and then my package is first package. Okay, so my first project under the source folder, under the package called first package, I'm going to create this class. That's what. If you want, you can change it over there. Okay, right now I don't have anything, only first package. This default package is actually what, if I'm not having any package, that will be default over there. That's the thing. I'll go with first package. Then here, my first project, why it's throwing error, still have not entered any class name, this thing. My first project, right now there is only one project, otherwise it will be showing you the other projects which are there under this field. So then I'll be giving a name for the class. So name for the class, if you want, I'll just give you, for example, right now, sample. Okay, otherwise I'll give first class itself. Can you see, now when I'm typing, once again it's giving me type name is discouraged for the class. So class level, always you should be started with upper class. That's it. Clear? So that is also a standard way, but not is the perfect way, or that is at least not a mandatory, it's a standard way of using it. That's the thing. First class, I created, now it's gone. Now I need to click on this main function. What is this main function? We'll see. Okay, as of now I'll click on this checkbox, main function. Okay, then I'll click on finish. Okay, I'll click on default as of now. Okay, these are all package access modifier. Okay, I'll let you know actually these things very, very soon over there. Right now click on this default, public static void main, and then click on finish. So I got this one. So right now the font size is very small. I want to increase the font size. What I need to do, we'll see later. First, we'll finish this one. First package and then first class I created. Now I'll come to the original folder location. Now when I come over here, under the source folder, under the first package, can you see first class, which is a Java file? Okay, I'll right click, edit it. The same information what I have got over there under the Eclipse, that is what I have got over here. Clear? So that's what. So then after that, this is a Java file which is there under the source folder. Now I'll come to the bin folder, first package. Can you see first class dot class? Okay, it's a class file. I told you that actually what, always when I'm going to do an action over there. Okay, so what the compiler will do, it converts the Java file into a class file. So those class files will be saved under bin folder. Okay, so xyz java, xyz dot class, same thing, first class dot class, then first class dot java in the source folder. Okay, now I'll right click and then try to open it. There is no edit option. I'll try to open. It gives you Windows can't open the file. There is no option to open this file. If you try to open with something also, it gives you some information which you cannot read. That's what it will be. So no one can read this information. Only JVM can understand it. That's why. That's why here they have given me everything under the JSS library as class files. So no one can understand what is the logic behind that. Everyone can know only information is what means. What is the methods and then what are the variables, those informations they given. That is what we can understand it over here. That's it. Clear? So if I come to my location over there, so what I have done right now, I have created over here, right, what are the thing means. So I'll just give some information. So I'll go with, I'm giving a lot of different colors. Okay. Don't think fully junk level. Okay. Just I'm trying to make it a little bit a comfortable way. That's the only thing. So first class dot Java. Okay. I'll copy this one. So I want the name of it. Press F2. Any information, if you want to rename or something, the package name or the project name or class name, always you have to click here, press F2, then only you have to rename it. Okay, you cannot rename here directly. Okay, always press F2 and then only you can rename it. Okay, I'll come to that part also very soon. So I come over here, I'm going to create Java file over here. Okay, this is my Java file. So what is my name of it? It is first class dot Java. I'll just decrease the font size a little bit for me to make it first class is dot Java file over here. That's the thing. Okay. So now the same information will be there under the original folder location. Okay. I told you. Okay. The Java file. So along with that, there will be my information over here, so I'll copy. So this is it. So this will be alone what, instead of Java, that should be class. That's another thing. Okay, because in bin folder always that will be class over here. Sure. Okay, that is class. So, still now everything is clear for you guys. That is actually I just given you the view, what is happening in the Eclipse level, and then what will be there in the original folder view. Anyone has any doubts on this one? Anyone has any doubts or something? Is I making you guys bored actually as what you guys know? If I'm repeating the same or trying to give this detailed information is good for you. I just want to know this information because I'm trying to give it in a little bit detailed manner. Is it making you bored or if it's making it extend the class or something? Just tell me over there. So I thought actually it will be a little bit useful for you when you're going for it. That's what I thought. So just a second. Okay, there is a question. Why original folder has two views? Okay, so the thing is in Eclipse level, that is actually what, there is no need of showing the class files over there. Okay, always whenever you create a Java file, a class file will be created by default by the Java. Okay, that is by JVM. Okay, because execution always happens over there under the class level only. Correct? So that's why in original folder view, always actually what? The class file is being generated, but the same thing is not needed over there in the Eclipse, so that's why they are not showing that information. That's the only thing. Okay guys, anyone has any doubts or something? Swapna, your answer is clear? Yeah. Okay, just a second, someone has raised their hand. So So anyone has any doubts or something? Deepa, Vanita, you guys have any doubt? Deepa, if you want, you can, I unmuted you. If you want, you can ask me any questions. Hello?
No, I don't have any questions.
Okay, sure. Okay, Deepa. Yeah. So I'll just continue. Okay, yeah, sure. So now we have created this one. So now I want to increase the font size. So how to increase the font size? I'll just go here. So I'll go to window, preferences. Okay, so where means I'll go to the window, preferences, then type your font. That's it. Okay, colors and fonts over there. Click on the basic folder. If you open it, if you come down, there will be a last information called text font. Okay, click on edit. I want to make it to size of 12 or 13 something. So I'll make it 13. Then I'll click on OK. So this is the size of it. If I want to apply and see, apply. See, this is the font size. Okay. Then I click on OK. So whichever you font you want, you can edit it over here. That's the thing. I think the font is visible for everyone. I think so. In case if it's actually not visible, please let me know. Okay. Yeah. You guys are not able to see my screen. Guys, anyone is facing the same problem? Everyone can see my screen? Everyone, just a second. Everyone can see my screen. Yes. Okay, just a second. For you now, it's clear, no, right now, for everyone. Can I continue? Okay, yeah, sure. Okay, so now we have created the class. So how a program will be written? Okay, so right now you guys have asked me what is the usage of actually what Eclipse over there. Okay, I'm going to show you the simple usage of Eclipse over there. So right now, what is this main function over here mean? Okay, main function is an executable function. Okay, always when you're going to run your program, okay, it starts to run the program from the main function level only. Okay, always it starts from there and then it will be executing. So for example, right now, I forgot to check over there. Okay, I forgot it to check the checkbox for the main function. So I will not be getting this main function right now. So in case if I want this main function to be, again I want it. So there is a shortcut. M-A-I-N. I will type it. Okay, M-A-I-N. When I press control space. Okay, that will give you this main method. Public static void main. Okay, I'll be getting that one. Okay. So, that's what. So public static void main. That is what you'll be getting it. The same thing if I want to do it over there in my notepad level. Okay. So in Eclipse, this is the shortcut. Because why it's happening all those things? Because of this JRE system libraries, there are some files which will help me to get these shortcuts. But the same thing if I want to do it over there in my notepad. Okay. I want to come over here. Okay, I want to type it perfectly, public static void main. There is no shortcuts over here because Notepad doesn't have shortcuts over there. So I need to type the entire information. That's the advantage of going with Eclipse, all those things. Okay. Is my voice stuck? My audio is not clear. Just a second, guys. I'll just check over. Okay, so now it's clear, I think so. So my main function, I got it over here. So now what I'm going to do over here. So first I'm going to type an hello world program over here. Okay, so how I can type over here means SYSO, I'll type it, then control space. I got system.out.println. Okay, so the shortcut for this main function is what means, okay, to comment any lines in a Java program, you can press double forward slash, okay, otherwise there is another way, that is star forward slash and then ending with slash star. That is forward slash, then after that star forward slash. Okay, this is another way. Okay, from where you want to comment multiple lines or something. Okay, so you can comment like this multiple lines. Okay, otherwise single forward slash will help you to comment a single line. So I got it over here. Then after that, so for the main function to get it, what is the shortcut means? MAIN. Okay, type MAIN, then press control plus space button continuously. You will get the main function. Same thing, system.out.println. For that to get it, shortcut is SYSO, then press control plus space button. You will get the system.out.println. So now I'm going to type some information. This hello world. So now I'll right click, run as Java application. Okay, I can run like this. You can get a window called console, which will give you the output hello world over here. This is one. Other way, can you see here run, an icon called run over here, no? So if you click on this one, that also will run you the program over there. Okay, two ways. One, you can click here, okay, which class you have to run, or run as which class information, Java application or which one. Okay, so right click, run as Java application. This is the thing. So now I'm gonna type some informations over there. So the shortcut for system.out.println is what? SYSO, then now hello. Okay, SYSO, welcome, SYSO, great day, SYSO, welcome to the class. Okay, and then can you see a star mark? Whenever I type information over there, a star mark comes. That means this Java file is not saved. So Control S will help me to save the file. Okay, then after that I'll right click over here, run as Java application. You can see I got it over there. Hello world, hello, welcome, great day, welcome to the class. So what are the information I have typed over here? The information I got it over here. So println is there. So now instead of println, what I will do, after this welcome, the great day, and then this one. So these three statements, I have given it as actually what? Hello. Okay. So these things, I have made it actually what? As print alone. Instead of print alone, I made it as print. Now I'll right click, run as. So right now, can you see, I have not saved the file. I'm going to run as Java application. See what happens. It gives you information actually what? Save and launch. Okay. So what that means, you can check, for example, there are multiple files that actually not been saved in your project or something, is it gives you everything. So which one you want to save, you can click on it, save it, then okay. So now it saves and then run it. Can you see now hello world, it prints hello, and then welcome, great day, welcome to the class, all is printing in the same way. That means the difference is, yeah, to know what that file is saved. Just again, I have some questions. What is the location of star? The star is what means, just giving me information that I have not saved this Java file over there. That's what it's giving to me. Okay, so star represent that actually what, I have not saved this first class dot Java file. That's what it's saying. So to know that file is saved or not, okay, that means if you don't have a star mark over here, that means the file is saved. Okay guys, yeah. So now, the thing is actually println is what? It prints, okay, hello world, and then line println is type the information, keep the cursor next line. Hello, prints the information, keep the cursor next line. Then welcome, it's only print. So welcome and keep the cursor here itself. Then print great day and then keep the cursor here itself. Then print welcome to the class, keep the cursor here itself. So println print, okay, these both will be using in our Selenium also. Okay, simple concept, println means type the information, move to the next line. That's it. Clear this? Oh yeah, thanks Aditi. Okay, so this is the way this execution will happen over there. Okay, so I think so everyone is clear on this part. Clear now? Can I go to the next level? Okay, so the same thing, how to create a project, source folder, package, class builds, everything. Okay, I have documented for you guys. Okay, this will be sent to you today. See, the same information as how to download the Eclipse. After downloading it, how to give the path for it. Then what are the things you will be getting it over there. How to create a project, package, and then after that your class files. Everything I have given over here. Okay, so if you have any doubts while doing these things, okay, make sure you just run through this document. That will give you so how to create the class file information and then how to write a normal program file and then how to run it. Okay, so as of now what I've explained over there, that is there in the document level. Okay guys, when I do SYSO control space, I cannot get the full statement. Okay, so you are typing SYSO and then you are not getting the full statement. Okay, I'll tell you what might be the problem. So for example, okay, public static void main is there, no? So here I'm going to type same thing, I'm going to type your SYSO, then I'm getting your information like this. So here I'm not getting SYSO over here for the system.out.println. Why? Because I told you that actually what main is an executable function. Okay, any information you type, you have to type SYSO here, okay, inside the main function, then press control space, you will be getting the system.out.println. Okay guys, if you print, type it over here outside the main function, can you see, I'm typing it over there outside the main function, SYSO, then I'm pressing control space. It's giving me to write a method, so if I click on it, see what happens, I'm clicking enter. It's giving me private void SYSO. That is actually, it's considering that actually it says a method over here, a different method. Okay, make sure you type it over there inside the main function and type your SYSO, so you will be getting that information. Okay guys, you are doing it inside, still you are saying the same issue. Shalini, can you just unmute yourself? There's a small doubt is there, I just clarify that alone. Shalini, you can unmute yourself. Just a second, I'll unmute you. Hello, Shalini, I have unmuted you.
Yes, Murali. So yes, yeah. I'm trying to do that SYSO inside my main, but I still keep, the first time I did that, there was an error. I mean, there's a pop-up window. I really couldn't catch what the error was, so I just clicked on it, okay, and I'm trying to do it now, but I don't see any situations or anything coming up.
So, you're doing it in the Eclipse level or you're doing it in the some other
Eclipse.
Place?
Eclipse.
Eclipse only?
Yeah.
Just a second. Hey, Nilesh, you're there. You guys can share your screen.
I don't think there's a way for us to share, but...
Nilesh here.
Hello, hey Nilesh. Yeah. Hey Nilesh, I just want to see my Shalini screen. Is there any way possible? Shalini to...
No, it is not possible because you are in the presenter. So no problem, Shalini. I can suggest you just take a screenshot and send us to at support@eclipsespeed. I'm just pinging you that email ID. Okay. I'm here to help you. In session only, I will help you out. where you're getting error. Is it
sure? Yeah, that's okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, Murali, please continue. I'm taking care of Salini issue.
Sure. Okay. Sure, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks, Shalini. Okay, so this is the way I got the information over here.
Okay. So now we have know how to write the program. Okay. So we'll see a little bit about variables and data types over there. Okay, I'll just explain you a little bit concept of that one. So can I continue or you want just a 5 minutes break or something like that? Can I continue the session? I'm talking for a long time. You guys should not get bored of it. Can I continue? Okay, yeah, great. I expected. Yeah, we'll have a break. Okay. Okay, yeah, sure. So we'll have a 5 minutes break over there. Okay, so right now it's 8:08. So again, we'll meet up by actually what? Another 5 minutes over there, 8:12. Okay, so 8:12, once again, we'll catch up over there. Okay, guys? So, and also, if possible, just give your comments over there actually what, how the session is going on. Is there any improvements I need to do? I just want to know that part alone. Okay, if anything is there, please ping me that alone. Okay, Shalini, you can just reopen your Eclipse and then try to do it. Okay, yeah. Thanks, Aditi. Yeah, thank you. So if anyone has any issues or something, please let me know. Okay, guys. What is the usage of actually what three information, okay, what is the usage of these three information, okay, or these two information for storing numbers and then this is for decimal? That is what we are going to see. So I'm going to give you an explanation, okay, which is not the perfect numbers, but I'm trying to make you understand what is the usage of this short integer block, okay. So for example, short, it can store values from minus 50 to 500. Okay, integer can store values from minus 500 to 5000. Long can store values from minus 5000 to some 7000, for example 20000, something I'm going to give. The same thing if I come to double, okay, any information that comes with the decimal, okay, so for example minus 1000.302, for example 4000.99, okay, that information is what means double, it can accept values. So this one minus 10000.002, 50000.00, okay, this is what. So this is what the values, okay, each and everything is like a container, okay, which can store. For example, short is what means is a small container which can store only minus 50 to 500, okay. Integer is a little bit big container which can store values from minus 500 to 5000. Then long is a little bit big container which can store more. That's it. Same thing happens for the double and float also. So now I have a value which is 300, okay, which is 300 right now, okay. Now which are the data types can support for me, okay? It is coming as 300, which is a number, that means short, integer, long only can accept for me. So if I see 300, it comes under the range of minus 50 to 500, that means what for me, short will accept, okay. Then integer in this range also 300 comes, so integer also accept. Then for me in the long range also that comes, so long also accepts. Clear? This is what. So now I'll be asking you some questions. I'll unmute someone, okay, you guys have to tell me what will be the answer. So now my number is, for example, minus 3000,
okay, minus 3000. Okay, so now I'll ask someone. So you guys have to give an information. So Shyam, can you tell me actually minus 3000, which variable can accept, which data type can accept? Shyam Chandran Kacheri, you're there? You can, I have unmuted you. You can just tell me there also.
That's under short?
Sure. No, minus 3000. Okay, so short can accept minus 50 to 500. Integer can accept minus 500 to 5000.
Okay, that's under long.
Yes, correct. Okay, so minus 3000 is there in between the range of minus 5000 to 20000. So long only can accept for me. Okay, yeah. Thanks, Shyam. So Swapna, you're next. So right now I need to 300.50. Now can you tell me which will accept for me? Yeah. Yes, Aditi, you're correct. So minus 300.50. Swapna, you're there? Vanita, you're there? Vanita, okay, so I'll just go over. Yes, so what are the things it can accept over there means, okay, minus 300.50, okay, which is a decimal, okay, only this double and float can accept over there. In between range, 300.50 comes under double and float, both the things it can accept over here. Clear, guys? So double and float, both will accept. Double and float, both it accept for me. Okay, this is what about data types. Clear? Everyone is clear about this one? Anyone has any doubts on this, understanding this data types, why we need data types? Anyone has any doubts? Okay, so I'll go further. Okay, now I want to store a variable over there. Okay, I'm going to talk to you about declaration and then initialization. So for example, integer I, how I can declare a variable, okay, integer I, when I give like this, what will happen? This concept is called as declaration. This concept is called as declaration. So what will happen right now? So this one, so it creates me one memory location over here, then, okay, this I will be the memory location name for me here. This I will be the memory location name, then this integer will tell to the memory location, store only integer values. That means store only the values which is there under your range. Okay, only minus 500 to 5000 only you can accept in this, because the box container is only can fill that much only. That's what. Okay, the original numbers will be different. Okay, this is what to make you understand this thing. Okay, the original numbers will be minus 3, 2, 4, 7, 6, something like that. It will come in a bigger number. So this concept is called as declaration. Next, initialization. Initialization. So what is this initialization means? So here I is equal to 10 I'm giving. So what will happen right now? It will search for a memory location which matches with I variable, then 10 will be stored in it. Okay, where 10 will be stored in it. That's what it will do. So here 10 will be stored. Clear, guys? So declaration and initialization can be also done in the same step also. Declaration and initialization can be done in the same step also. Initialization can be done in the same step. How? For example, integer a is equal to 100, when I give, what will happen right now? That creates me one memory location here. Then what will happen? This integer will tell to the memory location, store only integer values alone. Then this A will be the memory location name for me here. Okay, A will be the memory location name. Then this 100, it will check over there. It's an integer. In this container, this 100 can be gone. Okay, yes. From my side, 100 is in between this range. So that is what. Okay. Okay, yes, sure, Aditi. Yeah. Okay, guys. So this is what will happen over here. This is
declaration initialization. So anyone has any doubts, you can just ping me over there. So otherwise, we'll see how to utilize these information. Okay, we'll see how to utilize this information in the program level. We'll see. I'll just come over. So now, I'll create a new variable, which is class variable. Then I'll click on public static void main. So if I'm not checking this checkbox, I'll click on finish. I'll be getting a class here. Okay. So you can see over here, it's coming first package, first packet. What does this one means? Okay. So this is the package name. So this class belongs to this first package. That's what it's denoting over here. Then after that, here I want the main function means main control space. Enter. Public static void main. Okay, so always this will be the main function which will be helpful for me to execute the program. Okay, once if I have main function, then only I can execute my program. So now I want to declare initialize a variable means integer I is equal to 10. Okay, integer I is equal to 10. Then if I want to print it, SYSO, then if I give in double quotes this I, we'll see what is the output. I'll right click. Run as Java application. Can you see it's printing me I, but I want the value which is there inside the I variable. Okay, any information that is being given inside the double quotes will be treated as a string only. Okay, so there is a question from Shalini. Does main function always have to static void? Yes, main function always will be, it's this one syntax is compulsorily public static void main. Okay, then only it will understand actually what is a what executable function over there. Okay, this is a standard way of giving it over there. Okay, main function is an executable function over there, which is an inbuilt function in the Java. Okay, so next I'm going to give SYSO, then I'm going to give I. Okay, so now I'm not going to give in double quotes. Now we'll see what is the output. Run as Java application, which gives me 10 right now. That is, any variable which you are going to declare it, okay, you have to give it over there without double quotes over there. Okay, then only it will be treating it as a variable for me. Okay, any information which is given inside a double quote will be treated as a string only. That's the thing. So I want to print it I is equal to 10. So how I can do, I'm going to show you about concatenation concept. So in a double quotes, I'll just give I and then equal to and space. Then give plus and then I. What will happen? This concept is called as concatenation. Okay, now I'll run this. See what happens. Okay, I is equal to 10. Okay, guys. So now what I'll do here right now, SYSO. Okay, I plus 10. Okay, I'm going to give. Okay, so this one I'll just give this. 20 plus 10 I'm going to give. Okay, I'm going to give 20 plus 10. So me see what happens right now. Run as Java application. It's giving me 30. Clear? The same thing I'm going to give SYSO 20 plus 10. Now can we see what is the output? Run as Java application gives me 20 10. So what's happening, any information with double quotes that will be considered as a concatenation, it will not be adding. So this one will be treated as a number when I'm not giving it without any double quotes. When they give the information with double quotes, then that will be treated as a string over here. Okay, when I'm giving it with double quotes, treated as a string. Same thing, SYSO, then I'll just give 20 plus 10. Okay, one is a string, another one is a number. Now we'll see what is the output over here. Now also prints me 2010 only, because any information that is added with the string will be information for me string only. SYSO 20 plus 10. Okay, it can be left hand side or right hand side, anywhere it comes over there when it's been added to the string, that will be concatenated. That's the thing. Okay. Clear this? Clear about it? So, now we have seen about how to declare an initialize a variable. Now I'm going to tell you about the concept of variables over there. Okay, there are two types of variables that is available. One is a local variable, another one is a global variable. Okay, first I'll be telling you. Okay, any information, okay, any variable that has been declared inside a main function. What is declaration means? I already told, integer I. When I give like this, what will happen? It will create me a memory location. Okay, it will create me a memory location. Then after that, in that value only, sorry, in that memory location only, that 10 will be stored over there for me. Clear? So that is what I'm going to tell you over there. Okay, integer I is equal to 10 over there. So what will happen right now for me? Creates a memory location, in that it will store 10. So any variable that have been declared inside the functions, that will be treated as a local variable. Any variable that will be declared outside the function, that will be treated as a global variable. So I'll create a new class. I'll give global local variable. Guys, anyone has any doubts, please ping me over there. Okay, so it's an important concept over there which I'm going to teach you over there. If anyone has any doubts, please let me know. Okay, so public static void main over there. So here I'm having, if I declare a variable which is inside, okay, integer I is equal to 10, this is called as a local variable because I'm declaring a variable inside a function. The same thing, if I'm going to declare a variable outside the function, that is called as a global variable. Integer a equal to 100. Okay, global variables is of two types. Okay, this is global variable. Okay, any variable declared outside a function is a global variable. Okay, local variable means any variable declared inside a function. Okay, main method is called my which class, Bhaskar, that is actually how main method is called by which class? That is actually what, whenever you execute this class, main function by default it will be executing for you. Okay, so tomorrow I'll be explaining you with the memory concept over there, how the memory allocations are happened. Okay, so that time you'll come to know that actually what, how the memories are allocated and then how each and memory is being called and which memory is being used, all those concepts tomorrow I'll be explaining to you guys. So there you'll come to know how the program starts and then which memory will be allocated, which memory will be called for each and every step, I'll be explaining to you. So you guys will be clear by tomorrow session how the calling is happened, how memory is allocated also. Okay, so global variable, okay, any variable that is declared outside a function is global variable. So global variable is of two types. Okay, two types of global variable. We have two types of global variable. Okay, one is static and another one is non-static. We have two things. So simple, how to use it. Okay, if I have a keyword called static, that is called as a static variable. If I have a keyword called static, that is called as a static variable. If I have a keyword without any keyword, if I have a variable outside defined, that is called as a non-static variable. That's it. This is non-static variable. Okay, this is static variable, this is non-static variable, that's it. Clear guys? Static and then non-static variable. So how to print these information, I'm going to show you. So local variable, we know, if I give the variable name, automatically the local variable will be declared for me. How to print the global variables? So SYSO, okay, system.out.println, then after that from my side I want to print first the static variable. Okay, so static variables, the standard way of utilizing it always refer with help of the class name. Global local variable dot. Then, can you see here it's giving me information, A, class, main, all those things. Okay, so with this class name, I can access this A. Okay, if it comes as yes over there, that is called as a static. Okay, so static variable, I'm just giving over here. Okay, so now I'll right click and then I'll run it. It's going to print me for this one. Okay, always I told you main function start to execute over there. So I will print me 10, which takes here, and then global local variable dot A, that will print me 100. Okay, so then next I want to print me this non-static variable. Okay, if I want to print the non-static variable, always I need to create an object. If I create an object, then only I can utilize the non-static variables. So how the non-static variables can be used, we'll see. Okay, what is the difference between static and non-static? Okay, so yes, I will repeat you that one, static and non-static. Okay, so static variables, okay, it will be loaded on the static memory. Okay, non-static numbers will not be loaded directly into any memory. We have to load that information. So I'll draw a diagram for you guys how the execution flow happens, then you'll come to know the difference of the static and non-static, and then all the usages of it I'll let you know. So first I'll create the object and utilize it. I'll again come back to your questions over there when I'm explaining the program, so there you'll be understanding that information. Okay, so now non-static variable, I need to use it. So non-static variable, I need to create an object. How to create an object? Simple. So to create an object, so what I'm gonna do, I'll come over here. So my here, I'm going to create it. So class, so I'm just going to write it over there. It's simple. Class ABC. Always a class will have a main function which will be executed. Public static void main string arguments. Okay, so then here from my side, I'm going to declare integer I is equal to 10. Then here I'm having two variables, static integer A is equal to 100, integer J is equal to 200. If I want to access the local variable system.out.println, then if I give I, it will print me 10 over there. Static variable SYSO, then class name is abc.i, will get me the local variable, get me the global value, that is 100. Same thing, if I want to get my J, I told you that I need to create an object. How an object will be created means, the syntax for that is new abc, the class name in parentheses. So this will help me to create me an object memory location. So now object is created. So I need to give the reference. Same thing as we declare an initialize for a variable, the same concept. Then I need to give abc obj1 equal to new abc. So this will be the object name. This will act as a reference. Tell to the memory location, load only abc class members alone. Abc class global members alone. Okay. So that is how we used to use. So, okay, I'm going to come there, how the memory has happened over there. So once again, I'll explain you so you guys will be clear. So be with me. Then if I want to print SISO obj1 dot j, now if I refer, now it will print me 200 because non-static numbers will be loaded under this object only. Along with that, I told you global members will be loaded. That means static member also will be loaded in it. obj1 dot a. Okay, that also will be loaded for me. Okay, so this one I'll make it as B, so no confusion. So B is non-static member. Okay, A is a static member, that also will be loaded. Okay, so that means non-static members always I need to refer with help of the object level. Static members I need to refer with help of the class name, otherwise object name. If I'm using it under the same class, I can refer with help of the same variable name alone also, that is also possible. Okay, so this is how the execution. So now the same thing, now I'll explain to you guys in with the help of a memory location. How would this happen? If I execute this program, how the memory allocations is going to happen? So that is what I'm going to explain to you guys. Clear? So still now, whatever I explained, apart from this object creation over there, everyone has understood it. What is global variable? There are two types of global variables, one is static and non-static. Local variable will be declared always inside a function. Okay, this concept you guys understood? Yes, correct. Static members can be called with reference of a class name abc.a. Yes, we can call like that. Okay, so I'll just drop a memory location. Okay, so I'm trying to make you to understand the concept in a simpler way. That's what I'm trying right now. I'm going to try right now. So now I'm going to execute the program. Whenever I'm going to execute the program, so what will happen right now for me? It will be create me one memory allocation for me here. Okay, always when a class has been executed, it creates a memory location. Okay, the class name will be a package name and then some memory name for it. So I'll just give it as ABC. Always when a program starts, this will have a static pool. Always a static pool will be there. This will be the static pool. We have the static pool. So then we have the static pool. So in the static pool, what will happen? All the static members will be loaded. What are the static members we have seen? Static int a equal to 100. We have, then after that we have the main function. So these both will be loaded right now. Okay, only we have these two static numbers. One is static int a equal to 100. Another one public static void main. Okay, so these two things alone will be loaded right now. Apart from that, we don't have any static members. Then next, what will happen right now for me? Okay, I already told main function is an executable function. By default, main function start to execute. Whenever main function start to execute, a local memory for the main will be created for you. Okay, a local memory for main will be created. That's what will happen over there right now. So main memory start to execute. So I told you that actually it's an interpret level of execution. Compiler will check whether any syntax error is present, but interpreter level only, execution line by line will happen for me. Clear? Main function start to execute right now. Now what will happen right now? First, integer I equal to 10. So integer I equal to 10 means what? It's going to create me a memory which is I is equal to 10. So creates me I a memory, then equal to 10. It created. Then system.out.println I. When I give here as I, what will happen? So when I'm refer only with the variable name, so what will happen? Always the search will first go to the local memory. So right now they're in main function. So in the main function right now checks what is the I variable here value? It is 10. So prints me 10 for me here. The value 10 will be printed. Then abc.i system.out.println abc. When I give reference with the class name, always the search will go to the static pool. So in the static pool, it will check whether do I have, sorry, this should be A guys. Sorry, it's my mistake. This should be A. So wrongly I typed it as I. My mistake. Okay. This should be A. It's not A over there. So we got it over there. Okay, abc.a. So now we have got abc.a means first it will go to the static pool, checks whether a variable is present. Yes, we have a a memory location which is holding 100. So now it will print 100 for me. Okay, so then next I am going to create an object, because non-static members I told I can create only with the help of an object only. I can refer with the help of object. So I am going to explain you this right now. So how a variable will be declared? Integer I is equal to 100. Simply I'm giving, okay, some values over there. So integer I is, okay, no, I'll just take some other variable, so it's not confused. Okay, integer z equal to 100 I'm giving. So when I give like this, what will happen right now for me? It creates me one memory location. Okay, then this integer will act as a reference, tell to the memory, store only integer values alone. Okay, so here this information, then Z will be the memory location name, then this 100 will be stored. Correct? So the same thing now, this ABC OBJ1 equal to new ABC, what it's going to do for me here means? What this concept will do means, okay, new ABC, what it will do means for me, it creates me one memory location. Okay, it creates me one memory location, then OBJ1 will be the memory allocation name. OBJ1 will be the memory location name. This ABC will act as a reference, tell to the memory location, load only ABC class members alone. Okay, that is global members. Okay, load only ABC class members. So what are the global members we have in ABC class? That is this static int a is equal to 100 and then int b equal to 200. So these two alone will be loaded. Okay, so that means a is equal to 100. Then b is equal to 200. Both static and then non-static, both the members will be loaded. Okay, that's what this concept will do. Clear, guys? Everyone, can you show how the memory allocation done? Okay, so actually I just going to explain you once again. Equal to new ABC. So now what happened here in the main function, I'm creating an object. So in the main function, it creates me an object, okay, which is OBJ1. It creates from here, which is OBJ1. So then now what will happen right now for me? So OBJ1 dot B, so sorry, OBJ1 has been done. So what will happen? All the global members will be loaded. What are the global members? These two things. These two things will be loaded. Then OBJ1 dot B. Okay, so in the OBJ1, what is the B value? That is 200. So now 200 will be printed for me. Okay, so 200 is printed for me. Then after that, right now OBJ1 dot A. So it comes to the OBJ1 memory. There, what is the A value right now? A value, it's 100. So 100 will be printed. Then system.out.println A I'm giving. When I refer only with the variable name, what will happen? It goes to the main memory and then checks whether in main memory do I have A variable. No, I don't have any variable name called A. So comes to the static pool, checks over there, we do we have A variable. Yes, we have A variable. So that will print me 100. That will print me 100 here. That's what. Clear? Then finally what will happen? It comes out of the main function. When it comes out of the main function, what will happen? It deletes the memory allocated for the main memory. And then in the main memory only this object memory has been created. So it deletes that memory also. Comes out of the main memory. Then main function, then it comes out of the entire program. When it comes out of the entire program, static pool memory will be deleted and then the entire memory which is allocated for the class also will be deleted. So all this memory deletion will be happened by whom means? By the garbage collector. Okay, garbage collector is the one who deletes the entire memory. So that's the advantage of this Java. So if you go to C, C++, you have to deallocate the memory. Okay, that is you have to delete the memory, but in Java level automatically will be taken by the system itself. It allocates and deallocates the memory. Clear? Okay, so in real time when static type variables are being used, okay, so from my side whenever I need to refer the variables. Actually, what static is what means it will have only one memory allocation. Non-static means it will have two memory allocations.